the whole construct that this, the beliefs that these little private minds have power and have dynamics at all is part of the error as well. That the entire cosmos is a projection. And that when you try to pull it down in interpersonal terms, that still you're dealing with the realm of error. So, for example, like in psychology, when we talk about projection, psychotherapists might say, quit projecting onto your wife, or quit projecting onto your husband, your own issues of mistrust, your own issues of deception. And that's as if persons project. But what I'm saying is, the healing comes when you go much deeper and you start to realize that the whole cosmos is the projection. That people aren't projecting anything. People don't have individual minds. People don't have individual thoughts. People don't even have individual decision-making capability, even though it can seem like we have a room full of people and each of you decided to come to this church today, on Saturday. And it took all these decisions being in synchronicity for this to occur. There's a part in the teacher's manual where a question is posed to Jesus, how is healing accomplished? And basically in that section he lays it out, he says, healing requires one awareness, and that it is the mind and not the body that is the decision maker. The mind and not the body. What does he mean by that? He means that human beings are just constructs that seem to have minds of their own, they seem to have their own sets of private thoughts, and that each human being seems to have their own decision-making ability. But each human being is a body. So to believe that bodies can decide, and bodies have decision-making capability, is to fall right in the smack dab in the middle of the ego's error. And it's back like a spider going, ah, got you again. That's why interpersonal relationships, they're so tangled. Well, I'm choosing to get myself on the right track. I'm choosing to do my healing work, my inner work, and my partner is dragging their feet. They're bogging me down. They're slowing me down. I could go much faster if I didn't have this person living in the same house with me that is so resistant, that is so lazy, that is so mentally lazy, that is so unwilling to practice the scripture, and da-da-da-da-da, you know, as if the bodies have separate decision-making capability, and as if somehow these bodies have got to work it out, learn to be better decision-makers, and Jesus is coming along, and he's saying, you made the whole thing up, and you took the power of mind, and you gave that to bodies, as if you could give make up bodies, and then give each body a mind of their own. You know, we know that bodies have a brain, but it's the belief that each one has a consciousness. Now we even have movies like The Secret and everything that's coming out, and they're saying, I remember Candace Pert in, I think it's in, What the Bleep Do We Know, she was actually saying, every cell has a consciousness. Now we don't have individual bodies that have consciousness. We've given individual consciousness to cells. She says every cell has its own consciousness. There's a lot of cells in the body, so we have 6 billion bodies, and who knows how many cells, and they all have their own consciousness. What a mess. How are you going to get them all to communicate and be in harmony? And Jesus is coming along and saying, no. The mind makes a decision between ego and Holy Spirit, and you have to get so deep back into the mind to see the difference between ego and Holy Spirit and make a sane choice. Make a choice for the correction, not for the error. So this is very humbling, because you come through all your spiritualities and you come through all your different religious backgrounds, and now you get to the point where you say, okay, I created this leg problem, and I don't feel good about it, and I've been sitting here pondering this thing, but I feel guilty over creating this leg problem. But, you know, this creation is a word I would not use in the same sentence as leg problem. You know, creation is of God. God doesn't create leg problems. And Christ doesn't create leg problems. And who you truly are, the Holy Spirit doesn't even create leg problems. No real being creates leg problems, it has to be that it's part of the error. So it starts to give you a sense of like, wow, I'm glad I can even be wrong about that, that I created this leg problem. You may read books and say, oh no, you did. You created the leg problem. But it's like, no, the deeper you go into this, it's like, I had an experience one time where I came home and I put a plate of food in the microwave and I was doing the coursework for lessons back at that time and started feeling this nauseous feeling, and then it got stronger and stronger, and then I thought, oh my God, I'm not going to get to eat the food, it's in the cooking in the microwave. And I was watching my thoughts. I must have caught the flu or be catching the flu. And, oh, my dad had the flu recently. My grandmother had the flu, so I probably caught it from one of them. Da-da-da-da, nauseous feeling. Oh, I'm not going to get to eat the food now. And what if it's a 24-hour bug or the 48-hour flu bug? You know, I'm watching them all. At least I'm going to just watch the thoughts. And then the diarrhea feeling came in. And then the next time I was, run for the bathroom, unless you want a dirty mess. So I ran into the bathroom, and I sat down, got my pants off, I was on the toilet, and thinking, at least I've made it this far. And then my lesson for the day, in the Course of Miracles, finally got a little air time. Lesson 136, sickness is a defense against the truth. Ooh, very synchronistic. With the diarrhea, the nausea, and that lesson on that particular day as I'm sitting on the toilet, I'm like, oh yeah, that's great, that's my lesson. So yeah, Jesus had told me that morning, remember the lesson and let related thoughts from the lesson, very long lesson too, it's not like one of these little characters, it's quite a long lesson. It's right next to lesson 135, which is the longest lesson in the book. He's on his long face there. And so there was a lot of thoughts that come in from lesson 136, you know, that sickness is a decision. You may not like that, but sickness is a decision. It's like, and it's like love comes close to you and you want to feel little and weak and frail. So it's like it's a way of saying to God, back off. I'm tiny, I'm weak, I'm vulnerable, I'm little, and I'm not as you created me. And look, here's proof. Diarrhea, feeling of nausea, aha, stay away. And so I had all these thoughts flooding in from the lesson as I was sitting there in the toilet. And then I started to take a tack, which I've used, and this is important in the sense that at some point I had that all let go and I started to say, okay, if this is true, then, and I've experienced sickness, you know, it must be that I have some kind of value of sickness. Either I'm valuing the sickness right now, or everything that Jesus Christ has ever taught me is a big lie. Jesus Christ is the biggest liar in the history of the universe, or I'm just valuing the sickness more than everything that he's taught me. So I simply took that. Okay, that's what I've got to work with here. I can go for that rationally. So then it was like, okay, which do I value more? Which do I love more? Jesus Christ, the way shower, my best buddy, my teacher, my confidant, my best friend, the one that I turn to for everything, the one that I rely on for everything, or this valuing of sickness. So it was like, oh, I've got something here. If one is true, the other one can't be. I mean, everything he was teaching me was that sickness was an illusion and that love was a reality. So now, if I'm feeling and valuing sickness, I must be saying that Jesus is the biggest liar. I might as well be saying there's no God. Because all Jesus could talk about was God. So I might as well just say, sickness or no God. Sickness or no Jesus. You know, it's going to have to be one or the other. So I just kept, I took that as a meditation. I went deeper and deeper into my mind because it was like they both couldn't both be the truth. One had to be an imposter. So do I want Jesus to be the imposter or do I want sickness to be the imposter? And I went down, 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 sitting on the toilet in my mind using this to go deeper and deeper until I reached a point where it was like, it was just like, the words came out of my mouth, this is impossible. and it was like boom, boom, boom. It was like, and that wasn't the first time that it happened. I think earlier in my life, I seemed to have a cold or flu, and I started taking one of those Vicks, NyQuil or whatever. It's like, how much, a huge percentage alcohol. I don't even drink alcohol. When I was cold, I didn't feel like I was shaking one day. I just went, help! And then it was gone. Just call out Jesus. Call out for Jesus in an instant, and all my symptoms and everything went away. Wow, that's powerful. So you have experiences. Not, I'm talking theologies or concepts to kind of banter around or just to go to church and sit in a pew and say the words. But I mean, you have to come to a sense of honesty, self-honesty. It, either everything I've been taught is a lie, or this other thing that I'm valuing, though, is real. So it has to come down to that. So that's really what true spirituality is about. It's about practical application of divine principle. And the ego, of course, wants to hang on for its own existence and survival. So that's why all these defense mechanisms, all these distractions, you know, it's the whole world is like the ego's playground of distractions to just try to distract your mind from one simple thing. Be still and know that I am God. That's the goal. Be still and know that I am God. And then this huge myriad of defenses is made to guard against that. You know, knowing God, knowing your true self as one with God. So in one sense, as you start to go in with this, it's like, well, if the script is written and this seeming appearance is in the script, okay. Don't have to try to figure it out. Don't have to try to even figure how it got to be the way it got to be. Well, the ego made the script. If you must know, it made the script. It made the good-looking legs and the bad-looking legs. It made the flowers and the dog poop. It made everything. This part of the script, the black holes and the quasars and the stars. It made the mountains, it made the sunrises, the sunsets, it made the trash heaps, the concentration camps, it made the wars, it made the beautiful songs, it made the singing ugly sounds, it made everything. And then now it's part of a retranslation to come back to the point of seeing that it's all simultaneous. So in one sense what I'm saying is, you can take your energy away from trying to figure out how it happened, and you can take your energy away from the guilt of taking responsibility for the error. You know, really, there are so many appearances. Why would the mind think that it could hone in on a particular experience and say, aha, it's my fault?
I think that feels, and I think that feels, to me, honestly, it feels like it's like this one moment, you know, you can't sort of be in peace, you can't sort of be in love, you can't sort of do this, you have to do it or you don't have to do it. And I find myself sometimes I understand it all, I don't even see a scar, I don't even see anything, there's nothing there, there's absolutely nothing there, even if I try to look at the scar, I can't even see it with my own eyes. And then all of a sudden, there's the grip, the ego will put me back in again and say, there's something wrong. There's something again wrong with you. And it seems to be this sitting on the fence, swaying on the fence, going on the fence, going, you know, to the peace and back again, all back to the fear again. And that's where I feel like I am at the moment.
Yeah.
And it's not just the leg. And there's a million stories I could tell you, you know?
Yeah.
And there's so many fragmented thoughts. And I think it's just on the fence. That's how I feel like I'm on the fence. And when I listen to Holy Spirit, it says that my devotion to suffering is what's creating the error in the mind. And if my devotion was to peace, that's what I would be experiencing. It seems very simple. It seems when I communicate with God, it seems as it keeps on seemingly saying to me, simplify, simplify, simplify. To me, everything has to be simple.
Yeah.
And it feels like it is simple. Well, it is. It's just a matter of choosing. But then there's this ego mind that can somehow, you know, and use the spider, find that there's this tangled web that I believe somehow I'm not getting into.
Yeah, I would say, I don't know if you have heard of Louise Hay, you know, and what Heal Your Life, and she would look at the symptoms and start the tracing back in consciousness. You know, it could be very helpful. Although, again, only forgiveness heals an unforgiveness, and Jesus is teaching us there's no order of difficulty in miracles, that in the end, even that kind of tracing can't be significant. If there's one problem, and it's already been solved, and the whole point is to learn to accept the solution, then even the specifics, but don't seem like they would be have any relevance. But in one sense, you have to say the Holy Spirit meets you where you believe you are. So in the most practical way, when there seems to be a leg injury, an ankle injury, a knee injury, something to do with the legs, you know, the mind thinks that if it has a body, it can be mobile. It doesn't understand that it's everywhere already. So it thinks that it needs the legs to move. And so quite often I've heard stories of people that are like a postman who goes around, a mailman who sprains his ankle. It's definitely time to slow down, stop, and everything. And in the most practical way, that is very much a symbol. Everything's just a symbol of slowing down. It's kind of like you can choose to slow your mind down through meditation, through prayer, or if you're kind of stubborn and you think, oh no, I can't just be meditating, I can't be praying, it's too much to do. What will people think of me if I just pray and meditate? Then it seems to be a trick, a symbol that the mind uses to justify slowing down. That's why the postman sprains his ankle, you know, or so on and so forth. Why does the opera singer get laryngitis? You know, maybe there's a bit of pride and investment in those vocal cords that needs to be looked at in prayer and meditation, and laryngitis comes along. I mean, our friend Carolina, who developed infradenza, she called me recently from Spain, and she said, just moved over here from Venezuela, I've got my kids here, and she told me all this, and she said, I'm supposed to start doing sessions and infradenza with people, I lost my voice. I had to go into a period of days, weeks of silence when my, you know, intranet, that's like my baby, and it's like, there's definitely a reason for the laryngitis or the sore throat. So even if we took it from the practical symbol, and the Bible and the Course say all things work together for good, isn't it great if you can actually trust that and say, wow, even this is working together for the good. Maybe it's just a symbol to my mind that I can just take a look at. And you said you have been pondering, contemplating, slowing down. You can actually start to see the blessing sometimes. And what seems to the ego is a curse or a problem, suddenly, all of a sudden, you start to be with it. It's like, oh, it's a blessing. That's when you start to really get into that retranslation, you know, because it's all working together for the good. It's such a blessing to see in that perspective.
David, could you talk and share about the topic that I'm thinking about is divine providence. And I've been noticing for me lately that work and money have been coming in stages, and I've been wanting more of both, and that hasn't been happening. And as you were sharing from the beginning, you were talking about things being done through you, and the thoughts that came to mind is trusting that what you need will be provided, and I suppose I'm still having some trouble with that, that enough work and enough money will be provided if I let go completely and trust. That's not quite a question, but that's kind of the issue.
Yeah, yeah. That's perfect that you bring that up too, yeah. Because I've been working for quite some time with this woman in Florida, named Donna, and when I first started talking to her and working with her, she was working in a hospital, and then she wrote to me and she says, I'm getting clear, specific guidance that I'm to quit my hospital job and I'm to open a shop. She had done retail shops before, but it's to be body, mind, spirit. She went out on the drive and she looked, the Holy Spirit said, turn your head to the right. And she looked, it was a plaza, like a little plaza. And the Holy Spirit said, look over there, see that vacant shop? That's where you're going to have your store. So she was guided specifically where to open the store. She's got a little 10-year-old daughter. She opened it. She's had course groups there, what to believe groups. She's done counseling, readings, things that she never could have imagined doing. And then, financially, it started to just be more like a squeeze, and it was almost like, uh-oh, my shop, I could lose my shop. And so she found herself constantly praying, Holy Spirit, please provide the cash to continue the shop. And she did this for quite a while, even though it started to become almost like, well, why is not this prayer being answered? You guided me into the shop, so why would you guide me to do a shop so you want me to go bankrupt or... And so she noticed, she told me her prayers were, Holy Spirit, I trust that you will provide the cash. You will provide the cash, you will provide the cash. And then she started feeling she was like a plane in a nosedive when the cash wasn't coming. And then suddenly she just recently had an aha, was like, I'm kind of fearful here, and I'm really telling the Holy Spirit what I need. It's cash! You provide the cash. I'll trust in you to provide the cash. And she was starting to see, there's something happening here, David, where I think I'm being asked to trust the Holy Spirit to give me always the next step to take and the intuitive guidance, but to not to tell the Holy Spirit how it should look or tell the Holy Spirit what I need even, as if I know my own needs, as if I know my own best interest. And right before I came here today, I opened my email, a lot of spam, and one email from Donna, which I will post on the mailing list as soon as I put a reply to it. But she said, I guess the pressure and the stress was coming because I really kept thinking, this store has to succeed. This is my function. She had identified her function with this body, mind, spirit store, and fighting for her 10-year-old daughter and everything. She finally got that she didn't have to tell the Holy Spirit how to run the plan about the store and the cash and this and this and this. And so she just wrote to all her customers, thank you, a letter of gratitude, and she said, I'm now taking a step into divine providence. She said, I've been getting email after email from David and the Messengers of Peace. I've hosted them at my store. I've had them down here. I've had miracles with them all. She was starting to name things off. And she said, now I'm just seeing that this is my next step in divine providence, to quit interpreting the images and quit telling the Holy Spirit what the parameters are of the prayer, you know, of how I'm to be provided for. And it was such a joyful email of love and gratitude, boldly just stepping forward with trust, basically saying, I'm closing this door. And I'm going to have Course in Miracles meetings in my house, and da 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 da. And I'm taking the step of faith where I'm stepping off into this thing with confidence, and I'm really trusting in the Holy Spirit to provide the next steps instead of telling the Holy Spirit. So I think that's her story is a good story for everyone, because as long as we still think we have ideas of how we will be provided for, then it's like the pressure's on. We put the pressure on the Holy Spirit. You know, you better deliver. I'm expecting that cash. And if you don't deliver that cash, then there's a big problem here. I don't know if I can keep trusting you and believing you. If you're not going to deliver the payroll, you're going to deliver the cash. And when Jesus talks about money, he calls it a tiny little metal disc and little strips of green paper strips, he calls them, you know. He has, I would amend the course now and use the plastic cards. The credit card age, you had to add a few lines to it from the 1960s, 1965 to 1972, and it came. So, but basically, he talks about it as if it's, these are just silly little symbols. He uses them in context in Lesson 76. You really believe you would starve unless you had stacks of metal discs and green paper strips. You really believe that a sharpened needle will push into your vein will ward off disease. I mean, he's poking fun at medicine, he's poking fun at the commerce, he's poking fun at the whole thing. He's just saying, this is a dream. So you've forgotten that you're dreaming. And these are just dream symbols, whether it's a leg, whether it's cash coming in from a job or whatever, there's a much deeper context, which is you're the dreamer of this dream, and you're just believing you're in exile from heaven. But before you can awaken from the dream, you have to reclaim the position of being the dreamer. Just like you would tell a little child who had nightmares, you know, you're just dreaming. Honey, turn around. If the monster comes and gets you one more night, you turn around and you look that monster in the eye and you say, I'm not running from you. You are, I made you up. And you're just a figment of my imagination. And many children have actually followed that advice, and amazingly, the nightmare is over. When they put running from the monster, and they just turn and face the monster. And that's what Jesus is saying is, you've made up a world where there seems to be fear everywhere. Fear of losing things, losing a job, not having enough of this and that. And it's just like, turn around and face that ego. You're so afraid of what you think you did. You so believe that you separated from God. You seem to run out in time and space and form. And you're playing among the dust. And you're fearing all these monsters that aren't out there. You know, you got to take a look at the monster on the inside. Somebody asked Gandhi one time, he said, you know, Gandhi, do you believe there's a devil? And he thought for a little while, he said, well, if there is a devil, the only devil there is running around in our own hearts, that Gandhi said. He didn't put it out there as this big entity, an evil entity. And everything gets used. I mean, yesterday I was on the internet and they said, I saw a headline of this Dutch politician. Long-haired Dutch politician had published a movie that his party, the Dutch government said, don't do it, but it was kind of like an expose on Muslim hatred, and you had quotes from the Quran about, you know, having to destroy or something the enemies of Allah, and talked about terrorism and so on and so forth. It's been like a huge backlash around the world, people reacting positively and negatively to this video. And you might say Jesus and the Holy Spirit are like, whatever it takes, you're doing the interpretation. Is it a good movie? Is it a bad movie? Is it slandering someone? Is it bringing something to light? It depends on your purpose. If you have a reaction against anything, anyone in this world, then there's something to look at. If you're not really reacting to anything real, you're reacting to your interpretation, to an ego interpretation of something, and the whole point is to let it go. So, yeah, I have been writing a lot about divine providence and sharing that, because to me, that's where you really get down to the nitty-gritty. If I am sustained by the love of God, I need to let go of trying to tell God, tell the Holy Spirit, here's what I need, here's what I want, and all these different parameters, and just start to say, if I step back from all that and really trust that I will be provided for, I don't even know the form in which that providence will come. But I know the feeling of being cared for. I know the feeling of being loved. I know the feeling of being nurtured. I know that. It's in my heart. I've had that experience. And so, whatever shows up, I can be willing to accept the form of it. So, that's why I shared this story with Donna. She's just a place. And I, of course, myself, I was just saying in the car, when I have somebody that I've been working with, and they're taking their baby steps, but when they start to really commit, like, I am only going to trust in spirit, I'm not going to trust in anything I've learned in the world, my heart just extends out to them. I was saying in the car on the way here, but when I have a brother or sister that comes to me and says, I'm laying it out, and I'm going to join with you, and I'm going to really trust, like I've never trusted before, my heart just, you know, I said I would do anything for a brother or sister who comes to that point. Because it's such a point of surrender. It's like a little child sticking their hand up and just saying, lead me. You know, and my mind just feels that call, just to bond with them. So.
Yeah. Well, that's where I feel I'm at now. My story, say 4 weeks ago, was more Donna's story, asking for provision, asking for what it would look like, and then reading the Song of Prayer, which I really enjoyed, the pamphlet for the course. It talks about letting go of all specific needs and coming empty. So that's been the process in the last couple of weeks. So, yeah, I'm just waiting to see what it will look like and trusting more in that than what I want it to look like. And I think wanting it to look like something has been the block all along. It's telling the universe what I want it to be, specifically to provide for me, my son, etc. It seems all justifiable, but really it's not when I listen to what you're saying, what I know myself. So I'm trusting the true prayer approach. If you know what I mean, just letting go of all specific needs and trusting that whatever comes. The Course says the Holy Spirit will provide all true needs if we follow purpose. And so I feel to say I'm in that, coming into that zone and wanting to stay in it. So
yeah,
I appreciate your love and extension to that.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I would read that little pamphlet, the Song of Prayer, over and over.
Yeah.
And I would read through, whenever you ask for things, you're asking for the past to be repeated in some form in which you like. You would say, the secret of true prayer is to forget the things you think you need. That sounded crazy from a worldly perspective. It's true prayer to forget the things I think I need. That sounds kind of airy fairy. Oh, yeah. Just forget them. But he was saying, no, this, he really meant that. And so I found that every time I was still holding on to these perceived needs and wants, what it was he was saying, you're setting up jailers to keep the guilt in your mind. Every time you have these wants and needs and you pray for those things. So we're definitely talking about blowing past the level of consciousness where we have the movie like The Secret, where it's like, use the power of your mind to get the things you want. You want the house, the soulmate, the Maserati, or whatever, you know. I mean, it's just like The Secret is saying, use the power of your mind to manifest it. And this is, people who work with the Course and who work with their mind and consciousness, they get to that point and many times reach that point, and then the bottom starts to fall out. And it's like, whoa, what happened here? I was doing great with this manifesting business. And it's more of the Holy Spirit going, tap, tap, tap. Remember, peace eternal, let's not forget what the goal is here. You know, the goal is not the Maserati. Tap, 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 tap. Oh, yeah, well, yeah. I was getting a little mesmerized there. I thought I could reinvent my world or something and manifest everything that I want. But who is the I? Wants and needs all these things, you know, it's the ego that wants and needs, and that's what's getting undone for peace eternal. So it's really good. I mean, it's just another step along the way, so I'm right there with you.
Thank you.
You might get parts of it online. I know, and in one sense, you know, that's where your mind can truly come to a state of deep rest, because it does take a lot of energy. It takes a lot of mind energy to keep compartmentalizing which is what we're trained to do. We're trained to survive by compartmentalizing. We learn different subjects in school. We go through different, we go through classes where we have to go through different courses of study and different levels of study for those things. Workshops, curriculums, trainings, there's so much emphasis put on education, and then once you start to get into true spirituality, it's more unlearning and undoing. Those are the phrases and the key words. And it just, for a moment, it takes a bit of time to adapt to that. When you've had your whole life built on go, 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 bigger, better, more, learn more, achieve more, to start to get into this mode where you just say, okay, I'm willing to lay this aside as well, and instead of trying to learn more, just allow the mind to open up, the heart to open up. So that really opens an opportunity for trust, and then the more you keep trusting, the more you get more in tune with your purpose, and the fatigue goes away, because it goes to the ego. There's another ego emotion along with all of its other emotions.
Can you go back to the story of Dharma? Because that's where I find I get hooked up in my ego and personality. It's about decision making. She knew that the decision, but she was a nurse in a hospital, and then suddenly she came to see via that. With my mind, I might have an experience like that, and then I would have a devastating experience too. So I definitely have the ego voice. I can recognize that quite strongly. But there's always, even if I get another voice, I always have this other contrary one coming. And I think it is a human experience, and decision making is important right the way through, because just to get along in your life as a kind of grandmother, and you do lots of varied things. How do you discriminate? Because they both actually can sound very loving, and as you get along, first of all, it becomes very subtle when you go as you do the work along the way.
Yes, it's very subtle. You might say that it's a progression. In A Course in Miracles, Jesus has these different stages of the development of trust. So as your trust in the Holy Spirit grows stronger and stronger, then the context of the decision making starts to shift. In other words, when you've forgotten the heaven and the spirit, you get really wound very tightly into the world and the decisions of the world, then form decisions take on an immense importance. For example, if somebody said, if you had a choice whether to eat an orange or an apple or a banana, and a choice of the person you were going to marry, those people would say, well, those are two different orders of priority and importance. One is basically not that important at all, the other is extremely important. You could pay dearly if you make a poor choice as far as the life partner. But again, that's within the ego's framework. It has projected out a world, and then it makes a hierarchy of all the illusions, which then makes them not seem like illusions at all. Certainly the important ones are definitely not seen as illusions. Most people say, well, these things are important to me, these things I'm kind of indifferent about, and these things are negative to me that I want to avoid. And so when the mind's caught up in this ego trap, it just kind of navigates itself, tries to go for the things that are enjoyable and pleasurable and so forth, and try to avoid the painful things. And yet, when the mind's asleep and it's kind of caught up into this way of deciding, it's really unaware that the ego is a decision, and that the Holy Spirit is a decision, and that the mind is really making one decision, deciding for one or the other every single instant, even though this is pushed way out of awareness. In fact, there's a workbook lesson in the Course in Miracles, I Will Not Value the Valueless, which is lesson 133. And in that workbook lesson, Jesus makes an astounding statement. He says, every decision that you make brings you everything or nothing. And that just doesn't seem to relate on the human plane of things. You know, like every decision I make brings me everything or nothing. It's like, no, I make hundreds of decisions throughout the day. And, oh yeah, it's more like the French, comme ci, comme ça, you know. So, it's a little bit of this, a little bit of that. It doesn't seem to be life or death, or all or nothing. In fact, you know, when we grew up, I mean, a lot of us were raised with religions where they would tell us what a sin was, what wasn't a sin, how to be a good little boy, how to be a bad boy, and so forth. And we had to, you know, sometimes even Christianity seemed that way, where it'd be like, they would say, you know, it's really all or nothing. And I hated that all or nothing kind of feeling. And yet, when you go deeper into the mind, and you start to discern between these two thought systems, you can see that the ego is the nothing, and the Holy Spirit is the all. And that still, it does come down to all or nothing. And for most people, when they read the Course, it's like the voice of Jesus is very non-compromising. He doesn't kind of hammer away at something and then go, oh, just take it easy. And you know, you can compromise and fix a few things if you want. It's very, very uncompromising. So similarly, as we learn to trust the Holy Spirit more and more, it's like that ladder. Derek was talking about the Song of Prayer, and in it there's like a ladder of prayer, where basically the lower forms of the ladder, you believe in lack. And so Jesus is basically saying you can't help but pray for things of this world because that's what you believe in. Nothing else is meaningful. When you believe in lack and scarcity, your decisions are tied very much into lack and scarcity. And you're putting an enormous amount of effort into evaluating, do I want this thing or that thing? Do I want to go to this place or that place? The higher you go up the ladder, and the more that your consciousness starts to open up and expand, state of mind becomes more and more important. Whereas in the lower rungs, it's like, did you get it or not? Did you get the job or not? You know, did you get the promotion or not? Did you get the new car or not? Or the new house? You know, the outcomes, the forms seem so important at the lower rungs. And then when you get more and more into your state of mind, your peace of mind, the outcomes and the forms become less important because your mind starts to stabilize in purpose. And you start to make decisions based on your purpose. Jesus says, with anything that you are considering, you can ask yourself, what is it for? What is the purpose? What is the purpose behind it? So in this sense, not so important what you do or what you don't do, but it's the purpose or the motive that becomes increasingly important. And like you were saying, when you seem to be on a fence, it's not easy to sit on the fence the deeper you go in spirituality. You know, it's I did talk to a friend one time and I said, it's hard, sitting on the fence is like sitting on a barbed wire fence. And she told me, barbed wire? Hell, it's not a barbed wire, it's a razor blade. She said, it's like, she said, she used her term, it's a razor blade up your ass. I'm telling you this barbed wire stuff. She said, that's not a good metaphor. Because the parts of the barbed wire where you actually can sit on the wire. But she's like, oh no, this is a razor blade up the ass. I said, okay, very extreme point well taken. But that's exactly what happens as you go deeper. You become more sensitized. Slightest bit of deception, self-deception, you know, you can become distraught, annoyed, you know, you can feel out of the tune with the slightest bit. And the decision-making is then lifted up to what I call purpose. So you become more aware of the two purposes, and with everything, it's not so much a question of what you will do or won't do, but it's a question of purpose. For example, like I remember as I was growing up, my family was always visiting relatives, we had all the big days of the year, Christmas and Easter and holidays, Thanksgiving we have in the United States and this and that. We always have the big family gatherings. It was very much repetitive, you know, Thanksgiving. The men would all sit over there for like 6 hours watching football. The women would talk about two or three different topics all afternoon. It was the same thing year in, year out. It was predictable. They cut the kill, they got the turkey, they dress it up, they step it up. The men watch the football, the women talk about this, and it's like you could go any given year and be like, oh, and who died, and who got married to who, and who got divorced, and who's in school, and da-da-da. You know, it was like predictable, predictable. And then at some point, I just started to say, you know, with the Holy Spirit, is this really the best use of my time? You know, I don't want to be offensive or anything, but is this sitting there watching these football games and listening to this stuff? And it was like, no, this isn't the best use of your time. I have better uses. And so gracefully, I was able to say things like, thank you for asking, or I'll see how I'm guided on Thanksgiving Day, or I'm guided in the moment. And at first, when I would even say things like that, I would get, what do you mean? Aren't you coming this year? And we really would like to have you there. And, you know, there's all these hooks. I call them guilt hooks. You know, don't break with the status quo. You know, we'll be letting people down. They don't get to see you that often, only 4 or 5 times a year. So, you know, it's almost like you're obligated to go through the rituals. And again, I was kept asking myself, in terms of purpose, what's the best use of my time? What would you have me do if I could go anywhere? He didn't got to the point where I could actually pop in on Thanksgiving for a half an hour, say, hey, give everybody a big hug, love you all, blah, 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 and gotta be going, oh, don't believe me, just got here. Nope, really gotta go. You know, was able to start to use it in ways where it just felt like it was fulfilling.
Yes, otherwise it wouldn't be loving, could it, to just cut?
Yeah.
Then that's a win-win situation.
Yeah.
Is that the kind of...
That's how it works.
But yes.
It's like a graduating kind of thing. For the Holy Spirit, you, like when my mother would call and, you know, tell about this, are you coming? It should typically be 2 or 3 weeks or more before the event. I would just say, I'm actually just practicing, trusting my guidance and the intuition, and I'll let you know closer to time. She, at first, this went on for months, maybe over years of time. Make a decision. Can't you decide? Or really, I'm working on deciding after I say it. Of course, I'm teaching what I would learn, you know. I'm trusting, I'm being guided. And at first, you know, I was like, you can't just give us an excuse of guidance. But it was like, no, this is actually how I'm living my life now. And then eventually, that was respected. I just kept teaching what I would learn over and over, staying firm with it, and it loosened myself up from that. And it's the same with these kind of travels and gatherings. We were here, I think, on Thursday night, and I was talking with Julie about, and I was saying, you know, come up to Toowoomba, and, you know, we could do a gathering or anything. I said, oh, that's good. Just send me an email, and I'll kind of follow it away, so next time I come back. But it's like, you know, of all the potential possibilities, it's like the Spirit has a very specific plan for you as far as who you're to meet, where you're to go, what you're to do. But underneath that specific plan, it still comes back to this purpose of love and joy. You know, that you're not asked to do something that really isn't beneficial for the whole universe. More and more the context becomes what serves the whole instead of these narrow little parameters of what serves this personality, who will benefit, who will lose, you know, who will gain and lose. Those kind of parameters start to be let go of. And then you're making decisions from a higher perspective, which is basically what Jesus says, that everything you think, say, and do teaches all the universe. So you start to say, wow, my mind is important, and my decisions benefit the whole.